you for hosting me. And today I'm going to talk about what my lab and my husband's lab at Yale are doing. I have been doing for some of the things that we have been doing for the past 10 years. And what I wanted to, I titled this, I think the title that I gave that is different than what it is now, but it's basically what I wanted to show. I wanted to use as an example on how you can use modern molecular biology to approach conservation questions. And so that's why the title CSI, using DNA to unravel the mysteries of mysteries. Mysteries is why species arise and divide, and that's the speciation process, and Darwin called it the mystery of mystery. That's why that's the title, the origin of the title. So now, if I know how to act on this thing. So, as I said, what I do is called molecular ecology, and what I do is to extract DNA from various sources and analyze this DNA either as a sequence or bases or fragments. And then from that, this gives me some insights in the biology of the organism. So there are two kinds of really molecular biology. One that studies the processes and how the molecules work together at a very fine scale. And the other one is like me, using the molecules as a mean to understand the history of an organism. And so the history of an organism can help you, can help in conservation biology when you have endangered species, can help you in vector control to understand, for instance, more the evolution and why to control vectors that carry diseases like mosquitoes, ticks, tsetse flies, or in invasion biology to try to understand the origin of invasive species like plants or animals that are threatening endemic fauna or flora. But today, what we are going to talk about is conservation biology, and in particular, I have to get in the swing of this. No. And in particular, we are going to talk about giant Galapagos tortoises. As the name implies, they're only found in Galapagos, but in the Pleistocene, so not so far away, giant tortoises were spread all over the continent, all the continents except Australia and Antarctica. Then in the Pleistocene, something happened. Can you imagine what? Humans arrived. They start walking around, and obviously they found it much easier to eat a giant tortoise and capture a giant tortoise rather than a mammoth or a Siberian or a saber-toothed tiger. So they basically ate them all, and they survived only in remote oceanic islands that were not connected to land, and therefore our ancestors could not really go there and eat them. And these two locations are the Galapagos archipelago, which is 900 kilometers off the coast of Ecuador, and the other only wild populations remaining of the Indian Ocean tortoises is on the Aldabra Atoll. So let's talk a little bit about Galapagos. I'm sorry that I'm so okay. So Galapagos are located on the equator line, 900 kilometers off the coast of South America. They're on a volcanic plate that's moving, and this volcanic hotspot is spouting out land, which creates islands, like in the same way that Hawaii was formed. And there is a sort of conveyor belt because the hotspot moves, and so the older islands are the one located to the east, while the younger islands are the one located to the west. We know the age of these islands because of this, the knowledge of the geology of the system, and the oldest islands, emerged islands, are around between 3 and 5 million years ago, and the youngest islands, like Isabella and Fernandina, are even less than 50,000 years ago. So they are relatively recent. Let's go to the next. They never were in contact with, because of this geological feature, they originated from lava that was coming out from volcanoes that now are submerged. They were never in contact with the continent. And you can see some pictures. They show the volcanic nature. This is a submerged crater in San Bartolome. And you can see how the terrain can be pretty tough And these are, and the blackness, it's the lava that's still there. And these are some craters. This is Isabella, and you can see the volcanoes on the island of Isabella, and this is Fernandina. Now let's go see. Because of this isolation, I have to get rid. Okay. Because of this isolation, the fauna and flora of the Galapagos is very unique, because only few animals and plants made it there. And when they arrived there, they didn't have any competitors or predator, and therefore evolved in all sorts of unique forms that are only found there. And this is a small example, and I could give a seminar about that, but there are cormorants with no wings, they're wingless because they don't need to fly away from predators. The only predator is an auk, it's a Galapagos auk. There are marine iguanas, doves, seagulls that play at night, all sorts of marine and land iguanas, as shown. Okay, in the next slide, there are terrestrial iguanas. And they come in two varieties, a pink form and a yellow form. I didn't have time to put the yellow one. The pink one is a very recently discovered species. It was discovered 2 years ago. And its closest relative is the yellow iguana. Then, again, an offshoot of this land iguana is the marine iguana, which is the only iguana that lives that can swim. They feed on algae, on the mat, on the rocks. So why do we know a lot about Galapagos? And why it's a sort of mecca for every evolutionary biologist going to the Galapagos? Well, because a certain guy called Charles Darwin, while going around with a beetle, starting in 1831, he stopped among the various places where it stopped in the Galapagos and started noticing the incredible diversity and both in terms of fauna and flora. And that visit started him thinking on the theory of evolution through natural selection. And he also noticed the tortoises and their diversity between different islands. And talking about tortoises, there are the taxonomy of this species is, or group of species is quite in flux, and I'll show you why later. But usually there are 15 described subspecies or species. 11 of them still exist, while the other 4 are extinct, and most correspond to tortoises lineages that live on different islands. They come in 2 major distinct body shapes. One is called saddle back, and you can imagine why, because the carapace, which is the shell of the tortoises, has the form of a saddle. And in fact, Galapagos in Spanish means saddle, and they gave the name to the island. But also they can be found in a different shape, which is more domed. However, because of the variation that there is either between the domed tortoises and the saddleback tortoises, if someone would present to you, and because of the fact that there are intermediate forms between them in the various islands, if I would show you a tortoise, and you, based only on morphology, you could not say to which island it belongs. Although someone else thought that they could.
Captain Porter has described both from Charles and from the nearest island to it, namely Wood Island, as having their shells in front thick and turned up like a Spanish saddle, whilst the tortoises from James Island are rounder, blacker, and have a better taste when cooked.
Now you can understand why they're in danger, but we'll see a little bit more. And they continue, Charles Darwin, in his summary of the Beagle Voyage. Oh, the voice doesn't go on? What happened? So my attention was first called to the fact, to this fact by the vice governor, Mr. Lawson, declaring that the tortoises differ from the different islands and that he could, with certainty, tell from which island anyone was brought. I never dreamed that islands about 50 or 60 miles apart, because that's the distance that they are, there is between most of them, and most of them inside of each other, formed of precisely the same rock, placed under a quite similar climate, rising to a nearly equal height, would have been differently tainted. But we shall soon see that this is the case. So obviously Darwin, when he arrived, he marveled at the fact that there were so many different shapes of tortoises on different islands. Why are they endangered? Well, I hinted that already. Capricorn turtle said, but hideous and disgusting as is their appearance, no animal can possibly afford a more wholesome, luscious, and delicate food than they do. After one